Hello friends, welcome to the official YouTube page of Everest IAS Academy. So today we are going to discuss February 7, 2020 Hindu newspaper analysis from the UPSC prelims 2020 point of view. So before going to the video friends, I wanted to discuss about the recent batch which we are going to start online, that is a Super 30 batch. Friends, this batch is considered to be very important for this year a preliminary examination both for UPSC and TNPSC, because we are going to only select 30 students for this batch. And we are actually going to cover current affairs, most important topics which can be expected for this year examination. In addition to that, as part of current affairs, we will be covering this year recent economic survey, budget, and as well as the most important schemes which can be asked in the examination. In addition to that, we will also in this Super 30 batch, which will be available online in our website, we are also going to discuss the expected questions from each topic. So basically this will be if you join this program friends, you will be in a situation, whatever questions which they are asking in the examination, suppose in UPSC means you will be in a situation to answer at least 80 questions out of 100 questions in the examination. In case of TNPSC also, you will be in a situation to answer most of the current affairs which are going to be asked. So that's the idea behind this program friends. In addition, we are actually planning to limit our batch number of students to only 30, because we wanted to give targeted focus to the students who are joining this program. So we will be actually creating a separate WhatsApp group for the students who are joining, where a separate doubt clearing session will also be conducted as part of the program. And weekly we will be actually uploading only 3 classes, and this is a 2 months program. So we are going to pick the most important crucial topics and discuss from the examination point of view. So we will be covering 1.5 years current affairs friends in this program. So friends, if you are interested in the program, you can go and visit our website which we have given in the description box. So in our future courses in our website, these two columns are available which we can link, and you can pay the fees via online only. So we are going to close the registration by February 12th only. So friends, if you are interested, you can join this batch. So let's go into the headlines friends. So rates to fall despite RBI status quo. Basically what happened is that there are 4 concepts which are discussed in this article. First, we will discuss those concepts and let's discuss this article in detail. So first is the cash reserve ratio. Friends, we know already the RBI bank is the central bank of India. So it only regulates all the commercial sector banks, especially private sector banks as well as the public sector banks. So all these banks, what happens is that they have to maintain an amount of money in the form of cash only with RBI. So that is called as cash reserve ratio. So this is the concept we have to understand, and based upon the cash reserve ratio, we can actually influence the money which the interest rate which these commercial banks when they lend to the consumers. So that is the idea. So suppose if the RBI is reducing the cash reserve ratio, means these banks will be left out with excess money, because CRR is increased, means they have to maintain more money with the RBI in the form of cash. If it is reduced, means more money will be available, so they can go and lend to the economy. So the interest rates will be at the time they can actually influence the amount of money in the economy. This is the concept behind CRR. So basically it will determine the inflation. It can be used as an inflation control mechanism, because the amount of money circulation in the economy can be under control. Because you see friends, if the CRR is more, means what happen is that RBI, if it is charging more CRR, means commercial banks, they have to maintain more money with the RBI. Now it will be left out with less money only. So and even the interest rate will be high. So it will not be attractive for the business communities to lend from the banks. And whoever consumers are there, especially from the people, so they will find the savings interest rates to be attractive, and the excess money they will come and invest in the savings. So through this way, the excess money in the economy can be controlled. That's the idea behind cash reserve ratio. Second is that repo rate. So repo rate is the one friends, the RBI actually it will lend to the commercial banks at a rate. That rate is called as repo rate. So basically through the repo rate also we can also control the inflation. Suppose if you see friends, currently our Indian economy is in inflation only. We are facing food inflation more. So we are there is excess demand in the economy because more money circulation is there. Now if the RBI is increasing the repo rate, means now what it will happen means the commercial banks, so the interest rate for them, it will be actually more. So even the business communities will not be in a situation to lend from banks. So even the public will not be in a situation. So whatever excess money they have, they will also invest in the boost savings related schemes. In this way, we can actually address the, especially the inflation related mechanism in the country, because repo rate is only given by RBI to commercial banks only when they have any shortfall of funds. So basically if the banks are left out with Like high interest rate, high lending rate means even they cannot lend to the business communities. So this is through this way we can arrest the inflation in the economy. So that is the idea behind repo rate, and there is a concept called reverse repo rate. So that is just opposite to repo rate. So through the reverse repo rate means it is the rate at which RBI borrows from especially the commercial banks. Now what happens is that during the borrowing, this reverse repo rate is always kept lesser than the repo rate. Next article is, next concept is open market operations. It refers to buying and selling of securities. So government's securities will be actually like it will be bought and sold by the especially through RBI only and with the help of intermediaries like commercial banks. Now what happens is that if the RBI is actually buying the securities from the commercial bank, means it will actually pump the money into the economy. So when there is actually less money in the circulation, means that time we can pump the money into the economy and even for boosting the growth. Suppose if the RBI is actually selling the securities, means actually it will arrest the excess money from the commercial banks. So the money circulation and during inflation time, it will actually go and sell the securities. This is the idea behind open market operations. So friends, that repo rate and reverse repo rate is also called as liquidity adjustment facility, because it is used for adjusting the liquidity in the economy. And then the final thing which we are going to discuss is the monetary policy committee. So through this only, it is usually headed by RBI governor, and it consists of 6 members, 3 official members from RBI, and 3 member will be nominated by government of India. So it has been given a targeted range for maintaining inflation, that is 4 to 6% only. So this is the idea behind monetary policy committee. So this primary monetary policy committee, this concept has been actually we have introduced only in 2016 only, after BJP government came into being. So now let's go and discuss what RBI has done in the recent monetary policy meeting. So what they have done is that they have not changed the especially the interest rates. So they just wanted to maintain the status quo, especially the repo rates. We know repo rates is a lending rate which RBI charges to the commercial banks when they have deficit of funds. So they, we have kept it very unchanged because we wanted to see how the inflation is improving in the economy. Then we can go and target the slowdown in the economy. But in addition to that, RBI has done 2 measures indirectly without actually increasing the inflation. It has introduced some money into the economy to actually help the business and economy in particular. So let's discuss that. First is that RBI actually opened a window period. That is like it has introduced through repo rate 1 year and 3 year bonds has been introduced. So now what happens is that, so when it is RBI is lending, means through the commercial banks, means through this 1 year and 3 year tenure, we have kept the interest rate at just 5.15% only. This is considered to be lower because currently these RBIs have been charged interest rate of 6%. Now what happens is that the interest rate, since it is found to be attractive, we are actually planning to pump in 1 lakh crore through these purposes through the commercial banks, and in turn they will be given excess money to actually lend to the business communities when there is a demand for credit. So indirectly we are influencing and helping the, especially the slowdown in the economy, we wanted to address that. So in addition to that, the second thing what the RBI done is that we have actually reduced the CRR. One, this CRR relaxation, friends, as we have discussed, CRR is the amount which these commercial banks have to necessarily maintain with RBI in the form of cash only. We have relaxed this criteria for commercial banks only if they lend to 3 categories. One is a home, when they construct, go for home loan, these banks. Second is auto loan. Third one is the MSME loans. All these are consumer oriented and employment intensive industry. So this will address the employment problem in the country and also promote the growth in the country. So this is a recent decisions which has been made in the Monetary Policy Committee meeting, friends. So let's go and discuss next article. So next article is India African countries resolve to fight terror. So basically recently the defense ministers of India and African countries have met together and we have signed a Lucknow declaration. It's all about 2 things only. We wanted to address terrorism on the international front, and we also wanted to preserve the maritime security in the Indian Ocean region. So this is the basic idea behind Lucknow declaration. Friends, kindly remember this Lucknow declaration because it's very, very important for this year preliminary examination. So now let's go and discuss why they have actually, like, first thing as we have discussed, they have targeted the terrorism on the international front and in Africa in particular. Because if you see, friends, in case of Africa, in case of Somalia, there is a terrorist group called Al-Shahab. So it has its linkage to especially ISIS in addition to Al-Qaeda group. Now what happened is that these Al-Qaeda based groups, it is considered to be in Somalia. It is actually ruling some of the areas of Somalia also, southern Somalia. So it is considered to be a terrorist safe haven countries. From there it operates and it is carrying out terrorist attack in other parts of the country. So that's why actually like we have signed this Lucknow declaration so to condemn the all the terrorist attacks which are actually which are happening from across the borders of the country. So in addition to that, we have also asked the United Nations to come up with United Nations counter terrorism mechanisms, so on the international level to address the terrorist problems. Second thing we have focused is that especially maritime security. So why this is very important, because if you see friends, from India most of the trade happens to African countries, Central Asian countries, Middle East countries, European countries, only through Indian Ocean region. This is where most of the trade happens, through sea. So that is considered to be a blue ocean economy, because most of the India's crucial resources are also there, like polymagnetic nodules. These kinds of crucial resources, even fish resources, are available only in the Indian Ocean region, and we wanted to safeguard that. But we are facing two problems. One is that piracy, especially near the African coast. Second is the terrorism related problems, so which are more active in the Somalian regions. So we wanted to condemn both these through this, especially Lucknow declaration. And in addition, we are also selling some of the military hardwares too. We are actually giving to African countries. Basically, this they will use to address the security related aspects, piracy problems and terrorism problems. We have given them offshore patrol vehicles, and in addition, unmanned aerial vehicles, drones has been given, so that they can use to monitor the, especially the piracy related operations which are happening in the Indian Ocean region. In the editorial article on the front foot, it is also about Monetary Policy Committee's recent meeting regarding having a status quo, especially without changing the repo rate. So it is saying this is considered to have a electrical effect on the economy, and it will actually boost the Indian economy. That's what this author's idea is all about. So basically what he is telling means, as the government has introduced that 1 year and 3 year repo time, because RBI is actually lending to the commercial banks at a very low interest rate of 5.15%. currently the banks now pay 6 to 6.5% on actually like deposits. So in addition to that, this is considered to benefit them, because they are getting the money only at 5.15%, but from the whatever money if they get from the consumers, means that is considered to be they have to pay 6% interest rate. Rather, here from the RBI they are getting it at only 5.15%, which is considered to be lesser interest. So this will actually address the liquidity problem in the country, especially business loans can be promoted. That's the idea behind this article. Next article is listening to the call of the informal sector. So basically friends, we have to understand two things. In Indian economy we have formal and informal sectors. So informal sectors is they occupy around 85% in the Indian economy according to Niti Aayog's report, but formal sectors are only 15%. So what is the difference means, informal sectors basically they will be registered with, informal sectors they don't get registered with the government and they don't pay taxes. They are examples like roadside, street side shops, and for the workers, laborers also, no social security will be given to them, no safety net is there. But in case of formal workers, they will be registered with the government, they will be paying the taxes upon the profits which they get. In addition, the workers also, they have to give the social safety net. So this is the difference. But what the government is always doing means, it is always wanted the informal sector to convert into a formal sector. But what this particular author is saying, who is a former planning commission member, so what he is saying is that our government should actually go on support the informal sector, because it has two main positives. Because now whoever, since they are in the majority, now what happens is that any worker who is going and joining this informal sector, because they can easily get a employment, and the skill training will be given, the mentorship training will be given from the business leader. So the skill training will be happen very easily and very fastly in informal sector, and later these skilled laborers can go and get a employment in formal sector. That is the big problem of big advantage we have with informal sector. The skill training, they can get it easily. Second thing what this particular author is saying is that it is about global value chains. Suppose if you see friends, one example, suppose for the jeans manufacturer, lot of branded companies are in the world, MNC companies. What happens is that in case of Tamil Nadu, they supply the raw material to Tirupur Erode region, skilled laborers who are in the informal sector. Now they will actually stitch the cloth according to the demands and design. They will stitch the cloth, and in turn they will do the value addition, and then they will supply it to them, and then for that they will get a labor fee. So now the basic advantage why the MNC actually employ these people means because cost is considered to be much lower and they can get maximum profits. And for the laborers also, the skill is actually capitalized, and in addition they have been actually like getting employment also, and the skills are also promoted. And finally, the whatever the goods which the MNC is selling in the market, goods and services, the cost is also lesser. That's why they hire the people in the Indian economy for the jeans manufacturing. So like that, this any value chain, if you take friends, this author is saying at the lower end of that, they will be always looking for informal sector people, because they are the one who actually like the like cost benefits will be much comparatively better. So profits can be maximized. So our government, if it is going and demolishing this informal sector, means it will always create a problem for the people and even for the country also. So instead, what it can do is, what this author is saying, our government should go and promote social safety net for the informal sectors. That's what this author is saying, in the name of like creating health insurance schemes. So all these things the government itself should do. That's what this author is mainly discussing in this particular article. So in addition to that, as we have discussed, government is already doing and it is denigrating the informal sector. But most of the learning process is happening during the especially the informal sector only, when they join the employment. This whatever skill set they get, once they get it, they can come and join the formal sector. That time they will be getting the social net. So informal sector is indirectly helping the Indian economy only. That's what this author is mainly saying, friends. Next article is PM's first visit to Assam today since Citizenship Amendment Act protest began. So basically in this article, they are discussing about Bodo Accord, friends. So first we will discuss the Bodo concept. Now what happened is that in the state of Assam, as per the 6th schedule of the constitution, we have given special provisions to 4 states. That is ATM, you can remember. That is Assam, Tripura, Meghalaya, Mizoram. So for the whatever tribal areas is there in the states, we have given them separate autonomous councils. They can manage on their own. So under that criteria, what happened is that the first, as per the demand for all Bodo Students Union, we have created the first Bodo Accord. Bodo Council has been created and Bodo Accord was signed in 1993. Now what happened, it was very problematic. That was created during the Congress time. Now what happened is that then Bodo Autonomous Council has been created in 2003, and we have given some financial powers also. They can actually raise taxes from the people in their area, and they can also do the better administration of that area also. Road and infrastructure development can be done through that money what they get, taxation. Now what happened, this also we have changed it now. Now the new name is Bodo Land Territorial District. This has been created very recently only in 2020 under the BJP's Modi government. So now this is considered to be very crucial achievement of our Modi government. Why? Because under the recent amendment what they have signed, agreement, we have actually in the state of Assam, under the Bodo Territorial District, we have included all the Bodo areas, rather wherever the area where non-Bodo people are previously there under their control, we have actually eliminated those area. So this is the idea. We have relaxed those area. This is the idea behind this recent agreement. In addition, we will discuss about one more organization also, terrorist organization, friends. So basically, as we have discussed, this Bodoland Territorial District hereafter will consist of only Bodo peoples, and outsiders, if they wanted to go into this area, they have to get a work permit and they will not be given any right to vote. So that's the idea behind this. In addition to that, our government has signed this national, with respect to Naga groups, we have signed this various peace agreement also, that we will discuss, friends. So under that, if you see, so as we have discussed, there first this, there was a National Demographic Front of Bodo Land. This was actually considered to be a terrorist organization. Why? Because they asked the separate land for the land and country for the terrorist, especially for the Bodo people, which they wanted to govern on their own. So that time our government has classified them as terrorist organization. If you see their history, first they have created Bodo Security Force. It is a terrorist militant group. It was created in 1986 only. Then what happened during the 1990s, it went and in the state of Assam only, it went and attacked all the non-Bodo tribal peoples and Bangladeshi immigrants. That time our government got very angry. So what happened is that it wanted to control them. So during that time, it went and had its hideout in Bhutan. So with the help of Bhutan government, went for Operation All Clear. So during that time period, we have signed a ceasefire agreement with this National Demographic Front of Bodo Land in 2005 itself. Now later what happened, we went for crucial peace agreements with them. It was in the negotiation process for a long time. So in that National Demographic Front of Bodo Land, there were two groups. First is the Nabla group, second is that headed by this Nabla fraction and second fraction is actually like it is added by this song beat fraction. So now what happened is that, so one is a like progressive group and second is this Nabla group. Nabla group is actually it is headed by especially this song beat, who is considered to be a non-Bodo. But progressive group is the one with which our government has signed a peace agreement recently. And recent update is our government is also having actually crucial negotiations with the help of this progressive group, who is actually having a discussion with Nabla group, so that we wanted to sign a peace deal with them also. Next article is India's to study air corridors with Central Asian countries. Friends, if you see, in case of India, most of the trade as of now, it is happening through the ocean only with respect to Central Asian countries and Middle East countries. Now, what happens is that even for Europe also, we are carrying this maritime trade only. And as of now, it is taking like more time. It is normally taking 2 months time to deliver our goods. This is having a problem for our perishable goods, especially fruits and agricultural produce. So our government wanted to expedite it. So it is thinking about planning an air corridor. Basically, with the help of flight, we will transport the goods, especially to the 5 Central Asian countries, which consists of Turk only. That is Tajikistan, Turkmenistan, Uzbekistan, Kazakhstan, Kyrgyzstan. These are the 5 Central Asian countries we are planning to have an air corridor with them. So as part of that connectivity program only, we have 3 main crucial connectivity program that we will discuss in this article, friends. If you see, it is taking as of now 2 months to deliver the perishable goods like fruits. So this will actually make them to spoil. That's why our government is planning for air corridor that will only consume 2 hours only and our goods will be delivered. Now the problem is because if you see the land boundary, actually we can easily, like after Pakistan, that is a country, Iran. So basically we are unable to carry the trade directly with Iran because in between we have a Pakistan country is there. And that's why a statement which has been made by finance minister, like foreign minister only, external affairs minister. So our government is thinking about planning this Chabahar port and then international north-south transport corridor and then Ashgabat agreement also. These all are aimed at boosting the connectivity between the countries only on a fast track. So let's go and discuss that how it is operating. Under the Chabahar port development, if you see, this one our Indian government is developing in the country of Iran. Now what happens is that from the Mumbai, we will be actually carrying out the shipment trade. So from the Chabahar, a series of rail connectivity will be given up to the Afghanistan border. And inside Afghanistan, it is called as Garland Road. This road is called. And we will actually reach the territory of Kabul. So with Iran also, we can boost up the trade. And with Afghanistan also, we can boost up the trade. Instead of carrying through directly, see friends, because of Pakistan creating a problem for us, we are actually indirectly trading with them. So this will actually promote the better trade connectivity not only with Central Asian countries, also with European and Russian country also. So that we will discuss. That is the part of international north-south transport corridor. Basically what happens is that as of now we are actually carrying out the trade with Europe through this Red Sea. So Gulf of Red Sea. Now what happens is that it is taking more time to reach. So now what happens is that we have created this international north-south corridor. Under that, what will we do means we will transport the goods from Mumbai to in Iran. We have the Bandar Abbas. This is near to the Chabahar port only. This is currently active, but Chabahar is still in the infrastructure development only. From this Bandar Abbas, we will transport the goods actually with the help of road and rail connectivity. We will reach near Caspian Sea and then finally it will be reached up to St. Petersburg. And from there it is easy to transport the goods to European countries also. So basically, if we carry out through international north-south corridor instead of carrying out through this Gulf of Red Sea, means the author is like what various experts are saying, it will reduce our delivery time only by 10 to 12 days. So that's the idea behind this international north-south corridor. So it connects Mumbai, Tehran and Moscow. So basically the Moscow and even it reaches up to St. Petersburg also. Then final is that Ashgabat agreement. Here there are 7 member countries and India is also a member country, friend. So kindly remember, India has joined this agreement only in 2018 only, just 2 years before after Modi government came into being. And it consists of even Pakistan also and Iran, as we have discussed, and Oman. Remaining are 3 Central Asian countries, that is Turkmenistan, Uzbekistan and Kazakhstan. Next article is RBI opts for long-term repos CRR exemption to lower rates. As we have discussed, CRR has been exempted especially for 3 categories, consumer-oriented industries. And long-term repo we have given for 2 period, window period, that is 1 year and 3 year. This lending rate we are actually giving to the commercial banks so that they can go and lend the money to in the economy. So that's the idea they have discussed in this article also. So basically that Reserve Bank, what it is planning means, they wanted to enable the flow of bank credit to be productive. So it will have multiplier effect on the economy. That's why they have went for this crucial relaxation, especially through repo rate. We have introduced 1 year and 3 year tenure, where we are pumping in 1 lakh crore into the economy. In addition, we have also relaxed the CRR front, where banks can selectively lend to especially consumer oriented industries like auto loan, home loan, and then MSME loans also. So that's what they have also discussed, because various industries people, what they are telling means this is considered to be a very good master stroke, because we have announced a long term repo operation, because 1 year, 3 year means we are actually giving, and in addition we are giving a lot of amount, 1 lakh crore. So this is actually, and we are giving them at only at 5.15 interest rate, because currently banks are getting at 6% interest rate only from deposits. So this is considered to be cheaper interest, and targetedly they are actually targeting the consumer sectors, and it will benefit the growth of the economy. Next article is RBI extends one-time debt recourse for MSMEs. So this is regarding, friends, what happened is that as of now, due to the various slowdown in the country, the commercial realty sectors who have borrowed from the banks, they are unable to pay the money on time, especially the loans which they got. For them, our RBI has actually given them one-time debt recourse. We have given them a relaxation time period. So under that, only thing is they should not be there. Whatever loans they got should not be in a non-performing loan. That means they should, if non-performing loan means if they don't pay the interest rate for more than 3 months, that is 90 days, means that asset will be classified as non-performing assets. Suppose if they didn't come under the criteria, they will be given a relaxation for the loans what they have claimed under the MSME sector, reality sector. Thank you, friends. Kindly subscribe to our channel. If you have any doubts, please post your doubts in the comment section.